It being 7:05 on October 17th, 2016, I hereby call this special town meeting to order. Oh, I'm sorry. Annual town meeting to order. Not special. It's always special. On a motion to admit, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move to admit the following individuals: Elizabeth Rourke, Finance Director; Darren Klein, Town Council; Robert Toros, transcript with freedom of the floor; Carol Ducro, Town Clerk staff with freedom of the floor; Brian Carter, North Reading IT Department; Harold E. Miller Jr., custodian, freedom of the floor; Allison Kane, Performing Arts Manager; Maureen Stevens, Operations Director, Parks and Recreation; Jack Moskett, Troop 755; Catherine Moskett, 6 Summer Street; Dylan Moskett, Troop 750; Anthony Vitale, Troop 750; Michael Conley, Director of Finance for the School Department; Andrew Lafferty, Director of Department of Public Works; John Bernard, Superintendent of Schools; Mary Ann McKay, Treasurer Collector; Allison Olson, Human Resources; Debbie Carbone, Assessing; Daniel Mannion, North Reading; Michael Sorrigan, Town Engineer; Amy Lukowitz, Youth Services Director; Ben Tenney, Troop 750; Susan Magner, Veteran Services; Mark Clark, Water Superintendent; Danielle McKnight, Town Planner; Michael Murphy, Police Chief; Rob Carboni, NORCAM, Freedom of the Floor; William O'Brien, 8 Englewood Lane; and Jason Smith, NORCAM.
We have a motion to admit. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. The guests may enter the hall. Town employees can sit in the first two rows in the front center section. Other visitors should sit to my right. While they get seated, I'll go over some administrative matters. The teller for this evening is Jeff Simons. All registered voters should be wearing a yellow ribbon. All visitors should be wearing a black visitor ribbon. Please silence your cell phones if you have not already. If you wish to be recognized to speak, please come to the side of your aisle. We have student runners who will bring you microphones, and that is microphones. One microphone will be for the hall, the other will be for the video for NORCAM. I would also like to thank our student volunteers this evening: Cassandra Arsenis, Dominica D'Estacio, Elena L. Ferris, Gianna Moscaratolo, Madeline Knight, Marissa Galupo, and Shelby Downer. Thank you very much. We have another motion to admit.
Mr. Moderator, I move to admit Merrim Khan, 4236 Washington Street, Boston.
On the motion to admit, discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. If I could call on Mr. Masseri to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move to dispense with the reading of the warrant and to refer to the articles by number, and further to dispense of the reading of the return of the service by the constable.
On the motion, discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye. Opposed? Unanimous? Article 1, Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Moderator. Article 1, hear and act on reports of town officers and committees. I move to hear reports of town officers and committees as may be presented at this meeting.
We have the motion. Is there anyone seeking recognition on town boards or committees to make a presentation this evening? I do not have a list this evening, so I'll assume there are none. Mr. Prisco.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Very brief. I just wanted to give the folks here tonight a little update on the J.T. Berry property and where we're going. When we were here in June, I gave you an update at that point, and I wanted to do it again this evening. So since the June town meeting, we did hold a workshop at the library, give an opportunity for the public to come in, provide some input, give them some information, get some of their recommendations and suggestions of what they'd like to see go into that property if and when we sell it. And in between all that, we were also vetting and completing an RFP that is available at Town Hall right now for interested parties that want to purchase the property to pull. We've had over 25 businesses or interested parties request those proposals. Tomorrow afternoon at 1 p.m., we're going to have a pre-proposal conference. And we'll see who shows up. With over 25 people polling, we should have a very full room, we hope. It's very encouraging to see that kind of interest on that property. So after the pre-proposal conference, then we'll also, we'll wait until December to submit the bids. And then after that, the EDC, after the first of the year, will do an evaluation, provide a recommendation to the joint CPC and Board of Selectmen, and then we'll make a decision. So it's just a summary. I just wanted to give everyone an update and let them know that we're still progressing along, and I'm very happy to see there's a lot of interest in that property. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Prisco. Anyone else seeking recognition? Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Yule.
Board of Selectmen recommend.
Finance Committee. Mrs. Hobart. No recommendation? Okay. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Before we get to the Article 2, just another housekeeping matter. If anybody left their warrant at home and needs one, if you just put your hand up, they'll bring one down to you. Article 2, Mr. Yule.
Thank you, Moderator. Prior year's bills, I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $2,390.95 to pay bills of the prior year as specified in Article 2 as printed in the warrant.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Yule.
The Board of Selectmen recommend.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hobart.
Finance Committee recommends.
This requires a 4/5 vote. I see someone seeking recognition.
Take two hands. There should be a better way. Dave Doucette, 6 Carriage Way.
I don't
in the warrant, pardon?
Let me check and see if they're on.
Dave Doucette, Six Carriage Way. In tonight's article, in warrant.
Please hold it right up close, if you would, please.
Okay, in tonight's warrant, there are 9 articles that ask for either raised by taxation or transfer from some other source. From the Finance Committee, can you tell me how much money is left over on the total appropriation for this year's budget that was not used at the June town meeting?
Ms. Crivero. Wrong. Oh, sorry. Liz, go ahead. Town Finance Director.
To answer your question, from June town meeting, there is $0 available to raise and appropriate. However, there are available funds within budgets that are going to be reappropriated and moved to be reclassified into new budgets.
Does that mean for all the articles that are in this warrant, you cannot raise by taxation? It has to be from some other source?
That is correct. There is available excess raise and appropriate that comes from what we call new growth that is being used, but that was not available at June town meeting.
Oh, is that based on the new assessment?
Yes.
And that applies to this current tax year?
Yes.
Oh, that's cute. But anyway, that later in the warrant, there is a question. I think it's Article 8 or 9, where they're looking for a transfer of funds into the legal fund for the school building committee. Does that money, first of all, there was $200,000 that was approved last October. And the question is, I probably should wait till we get to that article. The question was, how much money was left still in that budget?
Yes, you will see that when we get to Article 8. It will be listed on the slide, the available dollar amount that is left in that fund.
Okay. At what point does that fund get closed?
We will discuss that in Article 8.
Okay.
Further discussion? This requires a 4/5 vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 3, Mr. Prisco.
Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $200,000 to be added to the Capital Improvement Stabilization Fund established under Article 5 of the October 1st, 2007 annual town meeting as specified in Article 3 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation, Mr. Prisco?
Board of Selectmen recommend.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hobart.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? This requires a 2/3 vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 4, Mr. Prisco.
Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $200,000 to be added to the stabilization fund as specified in Article 4 as printed in the warrant.
On the motion, does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation, Mr. Prisco?
Board of Selectmen recommends.
Mrs. Hobart.
The Finance Committee recommends the Town Stabilization Fund should have a minimum of 5% of net revenue. At the moment, we're quite a ways away from that. So anything that we put in lowers our risk factor and adds to our future security.
Further discussion. This is a stabilization fund. It also, again, requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 5, Mrs. Manupelli.
Article 5, transfer funds to other post-employment benefits liability trust fund. Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 5.
On the motion, Mrs. Manupelli for the Board of Selectmen.
The Board of Selectmen recommends passing over this article.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Horvath.
The Finance Committee does not recommend passing over this article. The latest actuarial figures for the town suggest that, in fact, the amount of money that we'd agreed to put into the OPEB fund each year is probably not going to be enough. This article was originally going to be passed over, and then with the advent of free cash, $125,000 was decided to put into it. This is in part because we didn't put in the full amount 2 years ago. However, I would suggest to you that the $250,000 a year is probably not enough any longer. So the Finance Committee is opposed to passing over this and feels that we should do it.
Further discussion? Mr. O'Leary.
Take it away. The Board of Selectmen does not have a different opinion than the Finance Committee in relation to meeting our obligations and trying to catch up. However, 2 years ago, we made a conscious decision to start chipping away at our prior liability, but more importantly, looking forward to what our liabilities are going to be. I mean, currently we have about a $60 million problem in relation to the OPEB when you look at the actuarial tables. $125,000 doesn't do a heck of a lot to go towards that. What we decided to do, starting last year, was to put money towards current new hirees and pay the obligation going forward, so basically stop the bleeding. When we first initiated this action, it was determined that our target was $250,000. We were unable to do that two fiscal years ago. We were able to do $125,000. At that particular point in time, we didn't make any obligation. We did not say that when the funds are available, we'll make up the other $125,000. We have an awful lot of other pressing needs, and as far as taking this $125,000 and putting it towards a $60 million liability, we think the funds could be utilized better looking forward to some other projects. Additionally, we already appropriated in June $250,000 towards our current liabilities going forward. We have an actuarial study underway right now. We'll get those reports, and if that calls for additional appropriations, we have committed to make it up. So if they come in and say, you need $285,000, you need $315,000, we will make up the difference in the current fiscal year going forward. So we think at this particular point in time, it's important to leave this $125,000 available as free cash for other unanticipated or other needs that we may have, whether it be for small capital or other capital improvement projects that we were putting off for years. So as far as the significance of it, our bond raters like it, but they already like us. So I think we could better utilize the funds, and the board does. We're unanimously in favor of passing this over. We appreciate your support. Thank you.
Mrs. Horvath.
I believe that the actuarial report has already been completed and that the new number of liability is well greater than $60 million. So in fact, we really should be at this point considering a greater amount to put in each year and not skipping over.
Pat Fillmore.
Hi. Pat Fillmore, 24 Fieldcrest Terrace. You say that there's not... you don't have to put it in this year, but every year you've got people retiring, so those monies are going to be needed throughout the year. So if you don't put in today, It's going to be twice as much tomorrow. So 2 years down the road, you're going to hit us with 2-3 times more than what you have to put in this year. So it doesn't make sense. Why not do it now and keep abreast with it, as opposed to not doing it and then 2 years down the road or next year have to double the monies put in?
We have been paying our fair share annually as far as whatever the costs are. What has happened a few years back is the federal government, they call it FASB, they changed the rules. And they said, you now need to put on your balance sheet what you anticipate your liability is going to be based upon current, past and current employees going forward, and have these monies available somehow or another. You know, so all of a sudden, they changed the accounting rules, and that's why it's now on the balance sheet. For years, it was not. Basically, we're doing a pay-as-you-go basis. What we've done in relation to the change is that going forward, as we hire new people, we are putting aside those monies to basically cover our future liability from a certain point forward, because we can never catch up. And it would be unlikely that the federal government is going to bankrupt every community in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, or the nation for that matter. So they just want to make sure that if you show it on the balance sheet, it's an accounting mechanism to account for what the liability is going forward. The board has made a conscious decision to make sure that we're covering it going forward, not just what our obligation is for the current retirees, but what new retirees we're putting money aside, $250,000 this year, to cover that future liability 20 or 30 years from now. So we could, there's no way we can make up the 60 plus, and again, I agree, the new studies out is probably $80 million now, which is, again, all the more reason to say, what's $125,000 going to do for you towards that?
Ms. Fillmore.
But you're already in the hole. Isn't it better to catch up a little bit as opposed to not catch up at all?
We have been, and we've started the plan, and we've initiated the plan, which wasn't in place before, so we have done that. We did it consciously with $125,000 the first year, $250,000 this year, $250,000 committed going forward, plus whatever difference we need to make up based upon the actuarial figures once they're determined on the new hires. So we have. But we also recognize, you know, $60 plus million is more than our entire budget for the year. So you're not going to make it up overnight. And again, throwing $125,000 at this point in time, we have other needs and other things that need to be taken care of. We think it's more advantageous to have those funds available right now. If it's determined that we need more, we have a lot more free cash to do it, sure, the board can change their mind, but not at this particular time. We're recommending leave it available, stick with our game plan, which is a good game plan. Matter of fact, our auditors thought it was an excellent idea that we took forward, took the plan of, you know, stop the bleeding, move forward, pay as you go now, including all the future obligations. And you know, as far as chipping away at the back, what good is it going to do at this point until the government decides what you have to do with it? They haven't even figured it out yet.
Mrs. Horvath.
The latest actuarial report indicates that we have a liability of $81,700,000+. This is quite a jump from the number on which $250,000 a year was based. The Board of Selectmen did come up with a good plan, and that plan has been working, but it's clear that it needs to be revisited, and any opportunity to put in an additional payment to the OPEB fund should not be overlooked.
Further discussion? Mrs. Bailey.
Thank you. Marcy Bailey, 21 Duane Drive. I have two questions. The first is, if we do allot the $125,000 now, where will that money come from, and what need will we be going without? And second, is the $250,000 annually that we're appropriating for new employees adequate actuarially going forward to cover those new employees, or are we getting further behind the eight ball there?
Mr. O'Leary.
First question, the answer to the first question is coming from free cash. As far as, you know, what is it, it is not, there is nothing specific that the free cash is earmarked for at this particular time. But again, we don't know snow and ice. We have other capital improvement needs that need to be addressed. We have an article that's coming up that we're probably going to pass over tonight, Article 9, as far as meeting the needs down at the football field for a public facility, which is in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, which we weren't necessarily counting on. So there's plenty of things to use the $125,000 for. Your second question was, our intention is, the $250,000 was our best estimate based upon the actuaries reporting to us last year. That's what we put forth, but we also committed to, if it comes in higher, right, when the actual calculations are made, we will make the payment. So the board's intentions are, and goals are, and stated policy is, to appropriate the requisite amount of money to cover those costs for new employees going forward, as we said, stop the bleeding. So, and we haven't got that final figure yet. So again, if it's more, we'll put in more. If it's less, we're gonna leave the $250,000 in there.
Further discussion? Rita Mullen.
Rita Mullen.
Sorry, both. One is for the hall, the other is for NORCAM. Just what you always wanted, two microphones.
I am in heaven. Okay, for those of you that couldn't hear me before, think about what it's going to be like now. If you're telling me we've already put in June money into it, and we've already put money in for that year, if Article 9 is going to be passed over, then I would be more comfortable putting money in next June, because we'd know better what we have for money, as opposed to putting this money into this account now. And that way we'd know how much money we have for other things we're going to do. Thank you.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? This is a motion to pass over Article 5. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Sorry, we need to count. Can I enlist Mrs. Bailey to help Mr. Simons?
You go try and get the feeling on it, then I would have spoken. I said to you that we would do it.
If Mrs. Bailey, if you could do the front and this side, Mr. Simons, the center and my right. All those in favor of passing over, please raise your hands. All those opposed to passing over.
Hey, you did a great presentation too. I don't know why they gave me this. Yeah, Abby's more convincing. No.
67 to 34, motion to pass over, carries. Article 6. Mr. Prisco. Mr. Prisco.
Mr. Moderator, I move to amend the FY 2017 operating budget voted under Article 20 of the June 6, 2016 annual town meeting as follows. Transfer from free cash, $174,598. transfer from line 10, human resource salaries, the sum of $30,000. Transfer from line 27, information technology salaries, $10,460. Transfer from line 46, DPW town building salaries, $20,715. Transfer from line 72, zoning board of appeals salaries, $4,500, for a total of $240,273 to be added to line 13 salary pool supplement. Number two, transfer from line 34, fire mechanic salary, $11,000, to line 32, police department expenses. Number three, transfer from line 34, fire mechanic salary, $15,000, to line 35, fire department expenses. Number four, raise and appropriate the sum of $92,325 for contract settlements and wage adjustments to be added to line 13 salary pool supplement. And number five, raise and appropriate $7,675 to be added to line 48 DPW road and street miscellaneous capital as specified in Article 6 as printed in the warrant.
Recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Prisco.
Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hovett.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Article 7, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move that the town vote to authorize the Board of Selectmen to petition the General Court for special legislation providing that positions of the police officers of all ranks, including policemen, shall not be subject to the civil service statute as specified in Article 7 as printed in the warrant.
On the motion, does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. O'Leary.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend.
Finance Committee, Mrs. Hovett.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Discussion.
You want to do that or you want to?
No, no, yeah, you got to wait.
Thank you, Mr. O'Leary. This article is before you as a result of contract negotiations between the Board of Selectmen and Superior Officers Union and the local Sergeant of Patrolmen's Union during the last contract negotiations. It was mutually agreed upon by the Board of Selectmen and the police officers of the department. This is in the town's and the police department's best interests. Just as a little bit of information, background information. Again, this article would allow the town to conduct its own hiring and promotional and disciplinary appeals process and decisions without being subject to the intervention of a state agency, which is the Massachusetts Civil Service Commission. Back in 1960, town meeting approved an act placing the members of the North Reading Police Department under the rules of civil service. Again, at the time, civil service was looked at nationally as a means of combating favoritism and giving government jobs which were filled. Much has changed at that since that time, almost 55 years ago, and including the civil service system and the way that it's being handled at the state level currently. Currently, there are 156 civil service communities, hopefully 155 after tonight or after the legislature acts with favorable action tonight, and 196 non-civil service communities in the Commonwealth. The Civil Service Commission is basically operated under the Department of Human Resources at the state level. They handle all of the initial hiring, all the promotional processes, and appeals of discipline for our department. And the process itself is extremely cumbersome to work through. The hiring process is extremely slow, cumbersome, and does not address our local needs. It's statewide and it's a one-size-fits-all. There's no local control. The process begins with a statewide examination. Some communities report that they had no or few candidates take the exam over the years. The exam is usually administered every April. The results of the exam are available in October, 5 months later. What happens is when a community has a need to hire a police officer, they requisition the Civil Service Commission, you know, for a list of candidates. The list is sent with a number of people who the community may consider, and it's restricted. Basically, if you have one opening, you get three applicants. The candidates list will be based solely on the score of a written examination, with the exception of veterans' preference and the dependents of police officers who were killed in the line of duty get extra points added to the score. They go to the top of the list. Additionally, if there are any police officers anywhere in the Commonwealth who have been laid off and have not been hired back, they also go to the top of the list. Candidates are then interviewed by the appointing authority, which is the town administrator. And then the decision is made and a conditional offer is made pending successful completion of psychological exam paid for by the town, medical exam paid for by the town, and a physical abilities test administered by civil service. If the town administrator selects anyone but the highest ranked candidate, he must put in writing why the higher ranked, this is again based on solely on the test scores, was passed over and was not selected. This decision is subject to an appeal to the Civil Service Commission by anyone who is aggrieved by the decision. Part of the problem that we've had here in North Reading is as we call for, and again, these lists are good for 2 years, the civil service list. They take the exam in April, results come out in October, they then become available. So if you have a vacancy, you either have to work off of an existing list, which may be 2+ years old, or you have to wait several months until the new exam results come out. And we've had a protracted period of time take place in numerous instances where it's been months and months and months, as much as a year, but we haven't been able to fill positions just because of the cumbersome process. Additionally, we have actually left vacancies in the positions of the department open because the field of candidates, we didn't pick anybody, never mind passing anybody over, until the new exam came out, in hopes that we would have better qualified candidates. So again, under our proposed initial, our hiring system, if town meeting approves this article, well, the town will be able to develop its own hiring system, as the town does for other employees, for other departments. There are a number of communities in the area. Again, we're not reinventing the wheel here. As we said, there are 156 other communities, 196 other communities that don't have civil service. But there are a lot of communities now switching. Reading has switched, Burlington, Needham, just in our area, have switched from non-civil service to non-civil service, because the process is almost immediate. We have our own, we can institute our own hiring examination. The scores can be scored within a week. We can rank them, we can use other criterion based on educational background, what they come to the table with. Educational background, other previous backgrounds and experiences, job experiences, which it cannot be considered under civil service. So again, we've had an inordinate struggle with trying to get the process going and fill these positions on a timely basis. Additionally, this proposal also would affect promotions. So people who are going to be becoming patrolmen to sergeants and sergeants to lieutenants would also be local initiative rather than civil service. It's important to note that the unions of both the superior officers and the sergeant and patrolmen have agreed to this proposal, are happy with the proposals that are in place as far as the policies and procedures that are already in place in relation to initial hiring, initial entrance requirements, minimum entrance requirements, as well as promotional opportunities. They've bought into the program fully, which is a wonderful thing. So as far as appeals and decisions, I mean, currently, the civil service provides a significant amount of protection for the employee. We have not had any problems here locally, per se. We've had decisions appealed. We've won most of them, but the policies and procedures that we have in place are satisfactory to the local unions as far as going forward. It's still subject to the collective bargaining, so they still have arbitration to, if they feel fully aggrieved. And again, as far as the Civil Service Commission themselves, due to the lack of staffing at the state level, the town's responsibilities have increased substantially because they just don't have, I don't know what they have, Chief, what do they have there now? Probably less than 20 people, I think, working for the Civil Service Commission for statewide, and that's for police and fire. So, again, just to go over some of the highlights and the bullets. Significant delays in the hiring process for new hires and promotions. No community or department-specific criterion incorporated into promotional examinations. State office has historically been understaffed, currently the worst in decades. Manipulations by some applicants as far as residency and layoffs, again, when they go to the top of the list and jump over some well-qualified individuals. Layoff from other communities go to the top of the list. Expiration of the state's discretion on any new hire promotion lists. Again, the lists expire. It takes far too long to fill these vacancies. And again, these vacancies, as they linger, we're paying for it with time and a half and overtime. Our overtime budgets go through the roof when we have vacancies in because we can't hire on a timely basis. Over-reliance on generic multiple choice examinations. Again, under the new proposal, we can establish some additional criterion other than just the multiple choice test, which is going to increase the minimum entrance requirements. Again, minimal entrance or promotional standards for the civil service, again, at just a high school or a GED, we can require more under the new proposal. The benefits for the community-based system, again, a hiring process can be specific to our community's needs, broader pool of candidates. I know for a fact when Reading puts out a call for examinations, they have several hundred people, you know, for two or three vacancies. Same thing happened in Needham. I had a son who was taking some examinations and he said, oh, you know, there were 300 people in the room. Whereas the civil service, five different criteria. Again, we may get a list with, eight people on it if we're lucky. So a broader pool of candidates, increased entrance and promotional standards, examinations held as often as we need it. So we're not tied to any timeline, artificial timeline. The status is, you know, once every 2 years, you know, as we need to fill a vacancy, or as we need to fill look to promote somebody, we can do it on our timeline and on a more timely basis. And again, the timing and hiring process are based upon the community's staffing needs and overall goals. The ability to require higher educational level. So the first step here is we need the approval of town meeting. So we need your approval, the board needs your approval to file a home rule petition with the legislature. In order for civil service to be rescinded in the community, it must be done through the legislature. We do the home rule petition here, which basically tells our legislators and the legislature that the town of North Reading is in favor of rescinding civil service and allowing us to create our own hiring process and promotional processes. The legislature will then approve the petition, goes to the governor for signature, and it becomes law. Once again, it's important to note that we had substantial negotiations with the locals here in North Reading. And they stand with us on this particular proposal, and we hope that you do too. Thank you very much.
Any further discussion? Ms. Capizzuto.
Hi, Loretta Capizzuto, 12 Duane Drive. I'm just curious, Mr. O'Leary, in the timeline of this, once it's submitted to the legislature, what is the timeline in terms of how it goes?
Mr. O'Leary.
I think that will be determined by our legislators being able to get something done, whether it be in this lame duck session. That would be our hope, you know, before the end of the year. I think we have some pretty influential legislators on our side, and we're hoping that they would be able to convince the Speaker of the House and the President of the Senate to allow it to come to the floor for a vote, and then I hope they would certainly encourage the governor to sign it. So it could be hopefully by the end of the year. If not, they come back into session in January. Right? Generally, they handle home rule petitions pretty regularly.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous?
Thank you very much.
We have a motion to admit, Mr. O'Leary?
Yes, you do, Mr. Moderator. I move to admit Scott Valenti, 6 Haywood Farms.
On the motion to admit, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye. Opposed? Unanimous? Article 8. Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move to pass over Article 8.
Recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Masseri.
The Board of Selectmen unanimously recommends.
The Finance Committee, Mr. Silbert.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends as well.
Further discussion? Seeing none, this is a motion to pass over Article 8. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 9, Mr. O'Leary.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Article 9 to appropriate funds for the construction of facilities at Arthur J. Kenny Field. I move to pass over Article 9 as printed in the warrant.
On the motion to pass over, recommendation for the Board of Selectmen, Mr. O'Leary.
Board of Selectmen unanimously recommend.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hilbert.
The Finance Committee unanimously recommends.
Mr. Bowers for the School Committee.
The School Committee is unanimously in favor of a project behind this to move ahead, and we're very disappointed that it has not possible to bring it forward tonight. This is a project we all need. Unfortunately, the development of it has been a little slower than we'd like, and we don't have a plan that is coherent and a price that makes sense to bring to you tonight. So as a result, the school committee unanimously has voted to pass over.
Further discussion?
Mr. Moderator.
Mr. O'Leary.
Just as further information for the town meeting. And again, as you can see up here, this is to the team locker rooms constructed. Probably we need to put together a bathroom facility down at the football field in order to meet state plumbing code requirements. As a result of the upgrade of the field a few years back, we became subject to the code. We have been operating under a waiver. The original, again, fortunately, we went back to the state and said, you know, what you're requiring us to do is kind of excessive, and they agreed to reduce the number of fixtures down 50%. That being said, last June, you appropriated $50,000 for engineering studies to work out a plan. We just got some recent figures in on this in relation to not just the bathroom facilities, but there's also a need to address the concession stand situation down there at the field also. So we're looking at the possibility of combining the two projects into one. One of the proposals is to just take the newly constructed team room facility and convert that into bathroom facilities and potentially add some additional storage space and concession stand. One is to not do the concession stand at all, and the prices are ranging anywhere from $460,000 to almost $800,000 in the initial proposals. We couldn't come to a conclusion, us meeting the Board of Selectmen, School Committee, Finance Committee, Athletic Facilities Subcommittee, and Recreation Parks and Recreation, couldn't come to a true consensus as of yet in relation to what facilities we should be putting forth for your consideration to finance. We're a little bit split at this point, so we didn't want to come in here without making an attempt. So this project is going to be remanded to the Athletic Facilities Subcommittee to study further. We still have over $30,000 in engineering funds available to look at different scenarios for us to come back to you probably in June with what we think is the most cost-effective way of meeting the needs for the community in the long term. So unfortunately, we had hopes of coming to you tonight with a proposal, just didn't come to fruition. So we'd appreciate you passing over at this point in time. Keep your mind open, and as we were talking about some free cash being available as far as
it may go towards something, part of it may go towards something such as this.
Rita.
Stevie did a terrific job explaining that, and I just want to say that certainly Marty Tilton, Parks Director, and myself are on the athletic subcommittee, so probably we had maybe more time to have been talking about the concession standing and adding to it. What Steve said is true. When the numbers came in over the last 4 days, they changed by a bit. So absolutely out of respect for finance, the selectmen, and if there are any school committee people that you don't think different, then we will go to the next meeting. But you know, we will absolutely continue to look at this, and that was why I asked the vote not to put the other money away in case we're going to need it in June. So it would definitely come up in June unless there's a special committee meeting for something before. If anything else comes on, we'll jump on that. But we'll have more time for everybody to get very comfortable with what the numbers are, and then everybody will just vote the way they feel in it. So thank you for your time, everybody that came out tonight. And I also wanted to take the time while we're here to thank the Booster League and soccer, softball, youth football, and lacrosse that donated in the past 6 months enough money to finish the field out front of the school for the softball field to do the irrigation. They came up with over $120,000 to get it done. So the school and myself from recreation want to thank all the leagues for coming up with the money to do that. Thank you.
Further discussion? Seeing none on the motion to pass over, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 10. Mrs. Manupelli.
Fund redevelopment wastewater plan for a section of Route 28 and 62. Mr. Moderator, I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $50,000 to fund a redevelopment concept plan, including but not limited to wastewater treatment options for a section of Route 28 in the vicinity of Route 62, and including any costs incidental or related thereto, as specified in Article 10 as printed in the warrant.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Ms. Mandipelli.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Gamer.
The Finance Committee recommends.
Does the CPC wish to make a recommendation and or a report? Mr. Pierce.
The CPC unanimously recommends.
Is there further discussion? Sir, just wait for the microphones, please.
Bob Atkinson, 82 Elm Street. And I just wanted to say, ask the question, how would this impact any future public sewer option that may be proposed, such as there's been discussion in previous town meetings about possible Route 28 Business District, Concord Road, and Martin's Pond area. And how would that impact any future costs and related to a future public sewer option? Thank you.
Mr. Pierce.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. We've been working on this sewer thing for a number of years now. I've been on the committee, I don't know, 15, 18 years, whatever, as we've tried to move this the sewer thing forward. So we recently had a review with MEPC that we did with a grant. And they took a section of Route 28 and evaluated it for economic development. And what we would like to do is, now that we have that plan, is take that plan and incorporate into it a wastewater treatment facility. Now, it'll probably be a package treatment plant, not a full-blown system. However, the question is, how will it impact the future? Well, what will happen is, once there are pipes in the ground, and we would probably try to make sure that if this got done,
that things were put in such a way that they could be incorporated into a future development. Now, we're not talking about putting sewer in here. What we're talking about doing is developing a conceptual plan so that when somebody comes in to develop a portion of this property that we had reviewed by MAPC with all of that information they've given us, we'll be able to give them a conceptual plan to show them how this could be done. It's a first step. We've been working on this for a long time. It's time for us to lead the businesses and help them get some kind of a plan going so that we can begin the process of upgrading Route 28.
Further discussion? Another question?
Pat Fillmore, 24 Fieldcrest Terrace. Just out of curiosity, redevelopment of unutilized properties on Main Street near 62. What underutilized properties? I mean, I drive Main Street 62 almost every day of the week, and there's not much underutilized.
Well, actually, there is.
Mr. Pierce.
The property could have a lot more intensive development if there was a wastewater treatment plant. The Heflon property, there is certainly higher and better use for that. There's any number of one of those properties. One of the things that keeps them from being able to grow is the requirement that you need so much land for wastewater disposal that it takes away from the developable land. It also limits the number of stories you could do by limiting the amount of water that you can actually use. A package treatment plant in that area would encourage development and perhaps something even more useful to the community than what's there right now.
But are you talking on 28, or you're talking about the Heflon property? That's on 62.
Okay, Mr. Pierce and Mrs. Fillon.
It does say in the vicinity of 28.
Wait. I want to make a point. This is not a dialogue between the two of you. You need to be recognized in order to speak. And there are others seeking recognition. So you need to be recognized in order to speak. That's always been the rule at town meeting.
I apologize.
Sorry to interrupt. Mr. Pierce, if you'd like to answer her second question.
The Route 62 is and Route 28 are both referenced in this motion.
Was there another question down here?
Just a follow-up quickly. So this is just a planning stage to generate a plan and would not impact any would not preclude any future sewer development of a public nature. It's primarily to develop a plan for a private use, multi-user facility of some kind. Is that correct?
Mr. Pierce.
That is correct, although we would certainly keep the concept of complete sewer on that in mind, and we would certainly encourage any development that happened, any piping that was done, to include the ability to expand on it.
Shut off our options. Thank you.
Up at the back.
Janet Nicosia, 2 Poplar Terrace. This is just a plan, but I apologize to say this, but it really seems foolish. We were looking for a townwide sewer. We've been approving at town meeting hundreds of thousands of dollars in plans to do a long-term study for wastewater and potable water systems. And now we're going to spend $50,000 for just a plan to then ask for town money to spend more money on certain individual businesses that are going to benefit from this. That plan that you're going to be approving right now is only going to benefit some people. So what you're saying is it's much more important to bring business into town than to clean up the water systems and handle the and have the people around Martin's Pond who are also held hostage by the size of their properties. They can't improve the size of their properties because of the septic systems and the raised systems that are there. So you're putting the, I understand we need to support business, we want to build the tax base, but why are we not going forward and spend this $50,000 on working on the real thing we need, which is townwide sewer that will go up and down Route 28 and include the places that have been promised during all those other town meetings when we approved money for studies?
Mr. Prisco, to answer the question.
I'm sorry for the confusion on this article that made you think that way. The investments that we already made in doing this research on wastewater, you know, we looked at four different options. We spent a lot of money in that study, and the best option that came out, the most affordable and realistic for us, is to connect Concord Street and Main Street through Andover to the Greater Warren Sewer District. That is still the plan. Unfortunately, it's extremely expensive to do that. What this Warren article is going to do, in the meantime, while we wait to come up with $50 million to execute that plan, we don't want to limit the ability to take properties, commercial-based properties, that are along Route 28 today to see if there's waited for redevelopment. And what you could do with this potential option, and you could tell me, Juan, if I'm wrong, is you could take, for example, the J.T. Berry property today. The person that wants to buy that property could go over and talk to Lincoln Properties and say, let's build a package plant, storage package plant together. We'll invest in it together. Now you need less waste area to put the storage when you use a package plant. And what this study is going to do is help educate the town. And these package plants have come a long way, but we're uneducated as a town on how to approve them. So we need to get educated so we can use this as an option. If people want to come in and develop in this town, we can now show them another option that we understand that we could approve for these septic package plants. This is worth doing, because for $50,000, we'll be prepared to help any developer, maybe even work with their neighbors to try to use package plants instead of having a septic system after septic system after septic system. You could take someone like the Horseshoe. They could get their neighbors, and together they could maybe find a solution where they could put a package plant and find a solution instead of spending another $200,000-$400,000 on trying to do a septic when it fails. That's what this is about. So we're not going to derail the plan to execute that. We did that study a long time ago. We're going to still stay to that plan, but it's just unaffordable at this time. I hope that maybe cleared it up a little bit.
Ma'am.
Excuse me, it is privately funded. And maybe CPC can explain that to you as well.
Ms. Knight.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify that the end product after a study was completed would be, the intent of that would be for private property owners who are interested in participating to actually fund the implementation of the package treatment plan. This is not intended to be a new town expenditure. The study, we would be funding and leading, but this would be a tool for us to help work with business owners for them to fund the facility.
Ma'am, are you still seeking recognition or?
No.
Sir, just wait for the microphone. Coming from behind you.
Yes, Dick Matolo, 432 Park.
A little closer. Thank
Dick Matolo, 432 Park Street. I deal with package treatment plants a little bit and have for a number of years. I assume all the absorption is going to be done in the ground with leach fields. And you're primarily targeting food, your supermarkets, your restaurants and that. It's a completely different ball game than doing apartments and residential. It's very high strength waste. And I don't know if the technologies are there. They're not cheap, I'll tell you that. but it's something to keep in mind. What you're targeting is, you know, mostly high-strength waste from all these food establishments.
Further discussion? Mr. Waller.
Hi, Rich Wallner, 57 Lakeside Boulevard. I'm on the Economic Development Committee. I've been going to the MAPC meetings. I've been very involved with this issue. The very big thing we're missing here is that the goal is to create a Main Street. And this area of our town that we don't have right now, we don't have a Main Street like we have in Andover or in Reading. The goal is in this area, it's ideal for us to create a Main Street. And part of that is for us to take a step forward and through these plants, these package plants, to make it more efficient for developers to build in our town around this area where we know we can have a really nice community center. Anytime you look at these community centers, they're always mixed use, residential, commercial. We have many, many capabilities in our town to make this work. The MAPC has proved that we have retail stores that could be put there, many things that would make our town very attractive. And right now, we have not really taken any steps to do that. This is one little step to have us go forward. It's really, we shouldn't be stuck on it's a sewage or packaged plant treatment. It's really saying developers, we want to change this, and we want to make our world better for the entire town. And that potentially includes, just so you know, 28's a highway. It's like Route 1. It's a highway with people driving very fast through it. The goal is to traffic calm that area so it's much more friendly to pedestrians, bikes, make it more of a livable, wonderful place, similar to some of the other centers you know around town. That's really the intent.
Up in the back. She's coming down to you. You need both, sorry. Can you hold them closer? I can't hear. Mr. Prisco.
Have you done a traffic study?
Is it about transportation? Is that what a question is?
Yeah, sorry. I didn't understand
the question. Just to clarify, your question was further, would further development increase traffic?
No, because we're going to...
Okay. And you're talking along Route 93 and the other surrounding highways? You have a valid concern, and this is how it should work, and the CPC folks can support me on this. As we do redevelopment, that's one of the things that has to be studied as we do the reviews, is the traffic. And if we have to require a developer to make an investment in our roads, in our ways to get people through town more efficiently, safely, that would be part of the decision making, I would assume, correctly. So it's looked at as we go through this. You want to add something to it from the CPC standpoint?
Yeah. Mr. Pierce.
Thank you.
Yeah, anytime that we do a development, we look at traffic very closely. If you ever go to the CPC meetings, you'll see that's one of the first questions we ask any developer. But we're also looking at, with the Economic Development Committee, we're looking at changing some of the traffic patterns, some, and maybe changing the speed limits a little to allow a little more time to help keep the traffic from being a big problem. So that would be studied, and some rearranging of some of the traffic patterns would probably come into play, which would solve some of the problems there.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Article 11. Mrs. Manupelli.
Fund repairs to town buildings. Mr. Moderator, move to transfer from free cash the sum of $50,000 to construct, reconstruct, or make improvements to town hall and other municipal buildings, including all incidental and related costs as specified in Article 11 as printed in the warrant.
Does the Board of Selectmen have a recommendation? Mrs. Manupelli.
Board of Selectmen recommends.
For the Finance Committee, Mrs. Hobart.
Finance Committee recommends.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 12, Mr. Pierce.
Mr. Moderator, I move to amend the code, the zoning bylaws, section 200-39, changes to highway business zoning and district bylaw. I move to amend the code of North Reading zoning bylaws, section 200-39, as printed in the warrant with the following change. Delete bullet number 19 and the following paragraph in the article, which together are a provision rate relating to the addition of multifamily residential housing 55 and over and assisted living facilities to the permitted uses category in its entirety as specified in Article 12 of the warrant.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation?
Yes, the Board of Selectmen will make their recommendation after the presentation.
Mr. Pierce, you have the floor.
The Planning Board recommends.
For purposes of presentation, Ms. McKnight.
Oh, I can do it. Thank you. Okay. I just wanted to explain what some of the rationales were behind the proposed zoning changes. Here's a map showing the target area for the zoning changes. It's the Highway Business Zoning District, which is all of Main Street. The purpose of these proposed changes really was to reduce obstacles to development on Main Street. We did a planning study over the course of the last year that showed us that in addition to needing to address some of our infrastructure problems, we really needed to loosen up our zoning in some ways and to make it more specific for what we would like to see. Some of what is proposed is for the purpose of trying to encourage mixed-use development. Some of it is to streamline permitting and make certain kinds of new proposals easier to be developed. There's some housekeeping and cleanup of some contradictions that exist in the zoning today. Elimination of some uses that don't provide sufficient tax revenue or amenity to the town. And the general overall goal of this is to facilitate creation of a downtown feel along Main Street, this in conjunction with other planning initiatives. There were a number of housing-related recommendations that we initially had in the warrant article, but found that they needed a little bit further study and consideration, and we intend to come back the next town meeting to address those, most likely in a smaller area and not for the entire corridor. So the addition of multifamily residential and senior housing is printed in the warrant, but we would like to hold on this provision in order to implement it in a more limited area at the next town meeting, and the CPC's motion is intended to reflect this change. So the changes involve the addition of adding mixed-use development to the purpose statement, allowing more than one primary use on a lot and more than one primary use within the same building through the site plan review process. And no additional, so currently you need an additional special permit in order to mix uses. You're allowed to do it, you just need another permit. And this clarifies that you don't actually need another special permit. Clarify the permission to do drive-up windows and outdoor storage of materials is given by the CPC as part of the site plan review process. And currently, you do need permission, but the zoning doesn't say who gives it. There were some contradictions in our prohibited use category. We have adult bookstores listed, but adult uses, including bookstores, are already allowed by special permit pursuant to our adult use bylaw. So this was inconsistent. So we needed to remove adult uses from the prohibited list and just state that they're allowed by special permit pursuant to our adult use bylaw. So there's no change in what's actually allowed. It's just clarifying that you can't prohibit a use while also allowing it by special permit. There were some additional prohibitions listed, things like cloud seeding, weather modification, rainmakers that I think are really from a different era that we didn't think needed to be listed in our zoning anymore. In addition, we were adding to the list of prohibited uses self-storage and mini warehouse facilities. Currently, it's not defined in highway business. In 1984, there was a zoning amendment passed to prohibit them, but in future versions of the zoning, this was not carried through. So today it's no longer listed, and we wanted to clarify that those are prohibited. Special permit use categories, we wanted to eliminate the following from the special permit uses: auto repossession services, because it's already listed and prohibited, and to add to the category of special permit uses, again, the adult uses that are already allowed by special permit. Hotels, rooming houses, camps, and other lodging places are currently listed as permitted or allowed by right, and now a special permit would be required because the CPC felt that this warranted a little bit, these uses warrant some further review to make sure that they aren't going to cause problems and that they're properly vetted. There were some changes to the dimensional requirements and density regulations that are intended to make development a little bit more appropriate to a Main Street kind of setting. We have a maximum floor area ratio of 2.0. We felt that this provision wasn't really necessary given that we already have other density controls such as height and mandatory setbacks in place. It just seemed like an additional unnecessary hurdle and would provide greater flexibility to developers in planning their sites. The minimum front setback is currently 25, and we felt that 20 would be, it's a small change, but just to, again, to give some more flexibility, a lot of the properties along 28 are very shallow. And in some conversation with local developers, we got feedback that that would be a welcome change. Currently, the maximum height of buildings on Route 28 is 60 feet, and we're not proposing to change that. But there is an additional four-story maximum, and we felt that both were not really necessary, that if you have a height limit, it should be up to the individual developer to figure out how large those stories could be, because different uses really call for different heights of stories. Currently, you can't park at all within the front setback area, and the provisions would change that so that you could allow parking up to within 10 feet of the front lot line. And that was the summary of our zoning proposal.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Yule.
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
Further discussion? This requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 13, Mr. Pierce.
Mr.
Mr. Moderator, I move to amend the Code of North Reading Zoning Bylaws, Section 200-69, as printed in the warrant, as specified in Article 13 of the warrant.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Yule.
Yes, the Board of Selectmen recommends.
Further discussion, Mr. Pierce?
The Community Plan Commission recommends.
Ms. McKnight?
This is there are two changes here. One, we don't have a stated minimum number of off-street parking spaces for medical offices. Currently, they would just follow the guidelines for offices, and medical offices tend to have greater parking requirements. And in addition, this would also eliminate a provision in our parking requirements that says that if you have a mixture of uses, you need additional parking in excess of the parking requirements already required for each of those uses. So we felt that along Route 28, that was excessive.
Further discussion? This zoning change requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor, please say aye. Opposed?
On behalf of the Board of Selectmen, I'd like to thank all of you for attending town meeting this evening. Mr. Moderator, I move to adjourn the meeting sine die.
On the motion, discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 13 was unanimous as well. Enjoy the rest of your evening.